that I'm going to describe tonight are research, and research really is a central focus of many of us here at the Broad Institute and throughout the world, of understanding the genetic basis of human diseases. And I always like to start out by expressing what our view of the importance and the role of human genetics in biomedicine really is. And what human genetics is all about is it's really understanding the true biological causes of disease. And in general, when we approach a disease from a medical standpoint, we approach it from the standpoint of the symptoms that we see and treating those and trying to address, improving the lives and the health of patients. But in general, we don't have therapeutics, drugs, treatments, other types of treatments for many diseases that are based on attempts to reverse the actual biological errors that are occurring that give rise to disease. And that's because we really don't understand what causes diseases. And there's a whole range of diseases that we don't understand the causes for. There's psychiatric and neurological diseases, autism, schizophrenia. There's late onset metabolic diseases such as type 2 diabetes. There's autoimmune and inflammatory diseases such as type 1 diabetes and rheumatoid arthritis. And we really don't understand what causes these diseases at a very deep biological level. And so the goal of human genetics is really to provide us with a unique opportunity to identify the biological components of these diseases so that we can learn about them and eventually learn how to treat them better. Now, it's often discussed as if the goal of human genetics was prediction of who's going to get disease and who isn't. This sometimes is a byproduct of human genetic research. Other times it isn't. In some cases, genetic discoveries may, in fact, help us predict who will respond to a certain therapy better than others, who will have adverse side effects from therapies. These are all excellent things, but these are all part and parcel of a larger view of human genetics as a discovery tool for understanding the biology of disease. And why this is important is that we live in a world right now where when we attempt to develop drugs, when pharmaceutical companies develop drugs, the vast majority of drugs fail somewhere along this process of picking a target of disease to focus, chemical development against, developing appropriate chemical compounds that might change that, and these might turn into drugs, testing them in animals, and getting to actual human clinical trials. And even of the small percentage of drugs that make it to clinical trials, the vast majority of those don't actually succeed at helping patients because they're not actually based on a knowledge of what's actually going wrong and causing the disease. So we need to change this. And the idea of human genetics gives us the opportunity to understand that biological basis of disease so that we can front load this process and end up with a much higher success rate at developing drugs. The classic example of this is why we have statins today. So Brown and Goldstein, several decades ago, first studied genetic causes of extreme familial hypercholesterolemia. So these were families that had extraordinarily high cholesterol levels. And they discovered that this disease was caused by mutations in a gene called the LDL receptor, and that the mutations, in fact, studying this, caused a lack of receptors that remove cholesterol from the blood. This work uncovered a very fundamental mechanism that's at work in all of us in affecting how much cholesterol we have in our bloods, and this proposed a very effective approach to developing a therapy for high LDL cholesterol, which eventually turned into statins, which help a very large fraction of the population today. And so this is just in a microcosm, one example of how human genetic discoveries shed light into biological processes that can then result in targeted approaches to developing therapies. We believe the same thing can apply across the board to a wide variety of diseases. For example, two of the first genes that were discovered as associated with risk of type 2 diabetes turn out to also be very effective drug targets for two of the three most commonly prescribed drugs for type 2 diabetes. This is a paradigm that really seems very sensible, yet has not been systematically attempted by the pharmaceutical industry simply for a lack of that basic knowledge of what genes and what biological processes actually cause disease. So it's important when we talk about human genetics efforts to understand a little bit about how certain diseases and phenotypes have a very simple genetic disposition, and others have a much more complex manifestation. So there are some diseases, and we often refer to these as Mendelian or monogenic diseases, and Mendelian simply because they adhere to Mendel's laws, that travel very predictably and very consistently in a rare set of families in any population. And so these are diseases or traits that we refer to as, we think about as severe genetic diseases. They travel in a Mendelian fashion, dominant or recessive in most cases. And these are caused by mutations in a single gene. And the mutations in these cases are deterministic of disease. If you have mutations that predispose to these diseases, you will get these diseases. And if you don't have those mutations, you won't. So this is a very simple genetic scenario that gives rise to a wide range of severe genetic disorders. However, most human traits, for example, height, do not behave in that simple fashion. There are not two heights in the world and everybody gets one or the other. Height, at the same time, though, is a very highly heritable phenotype. So if you know the heights of your two parents, your two biological parents, your height can be predicted very, very accurately based on that knowledge and the knowledge of your gender. Very simple information to come by. However, despite the fact that height is one of the most heritable things that exists, there's no simple pattern of inheritance. It doesn't follow a dominant or recessive pattern of inheritance. And furthermore, we can observe that even in the case of height, which seems like the least environmentally influenced of traits, there can be some influence of the environment. For example, malnutrition during youth can result in shorter stature at adulthood. So this rather dichotomy between traits that behave very, very simply as opposed, you know, as the consequence of one gene, and traits that are affected by many genes, was first resolved nearly 100 years ago by the great statistician Ronald Fisher. And he realized that there wasn't really a dichotomy here. What we were talking about when we examined traits like height was that, in fact, height was probably governed by not a single gene, but by small contributions from tens or hundreds of genes. And those small contributions all add up to where you end up is as an adult in terms of stature. Yet no single gene particularly accounts for a great deal of this story. And so with complex traits, such as height and weight and these types of things, instead of one gene determining your height or weight, many genes each exert a small influence. And none of them by themselves can fully explain what your adult stature is going to be. But together with environmental influences in some cases, these combine to define an individual's outcome. Now, the interesting, the surprising, curious thing is that most common diseases work this way rather than the single Mendelian way. And this is because when you think about it, at their heart, most of the common and complex diseases that we deal with are actually not things in which the population falls into two clearly distinct groups. For example, diabetes and hypertension are defined as you exceed a certain threshold on a certain biological test. The whole population has sort of a normal distribution of results from that test that, in fact, very much resemble the situation we deal with when we look at a population distribution of height. And so we have come to realize that in our approach to the genetics of complex diseases, we need to think about the fact that these are not likely to be caused by one gene, but likely the contributions of many, many genes, and what those genes together might tell us about the biological processes of disease. And so for most of my career, and really most of the historical field of human genetics, has been focused on the question of how do we find these genes? Because in advance of finding these genes, asking all the exciting downstream questions about what the biological processes are and what the genes do and how we might reverse them therapeutically are all exciting questions, but we simply can't ask them until we actually find what those genes are. So the scope of the challenge is the finite but very, very large search space of the human genome. And to refresh everyone, the human genome, within each cell in your body, you carry two copies of the human genome. These fall into 23 chromosomes, 22 paired autosomes in the sex chromosomes. And there are about, let's say, 20,000 genes scattered in and amongst more than 3 billion letters of DNA across those 23 chromosomes. And so if you think of the search space as 20,000 genes or 3.2 billion letters of DNA, that's a pretty large search space. Even if there are 100 genes to find, they're likely scattered far and wide in that search space. So the first approach that has been very successful for the single gene disorders, those Mendelian disorders, is based on ideas that were also generated nearly a century ago. And these were ideas that were also developed by early geneticists who were early statisticians. They were really one and the same. The field of statistics was born out of an interest in the genetics and the heritability of human traits. And what these folks here, Sturtevant and Morgan and others, realized was that they had found in genetics a possible resolution to one of Mendel's conundrums, which was that while most of the traits that Mendel measured in his peas and beans and so forth traveled independently, like the color and whether or not the pea was shriveled or smooth, traveled independently, some of those traits actually traveled together. That if you had a cross with a certain color, you know, two different colored parents and two different types of seeds, that in fact you always got out one color with one shape seed and the other color with the other shape seed, which didn't make sense to Mendel. And what was realized was that, in fact, the discrete genes of inheritance, they didn't know they were genes at this time, actually traveled together linearly on chromosomes, not by themselves individually. And so was born the idea that we could actually zero in on the genes responsible for disease, even in advance of, I mean, the mathematics and the application of this was developed even in advance of an understanding of the structure of DNA and an ability to study DNA base by base. And the idea is simply that by looking at a family or looking at a small set of families, we can track the inheritance of a disease here marked in colors, red being affected individuals and green being unaffected individuals. And we could track the inheritance of that disease from generation to generation and at the same time look at DNA polymorphisms or other types of markers along the chromosome that would direct us to identify places in the genome where in this family, this certain DNA mutation or polymorphism tracked with the inheritance of disease. And if we were to observe this in a series of families, we would quickly zero in on which chromosome and which arm of which chromosome the disease gene for any of many possible diseases might reside. And so this is the basis for a great success in the 80s and 90s in particular for the localization of genes for those Mendelian or single gene disorders. And this worked very well because all of these types of diseases were caused by mutations basically in one gene. And so that strategy, which we won't go into any particular detail on here, was to basically start with the whole genome, use those families to zero in on a particular chromosomal arm, and then to zero in by looking at a number of different families on specific smaller regions until you found the right gene that had mutations. And over the course of the 90s, more than 1,000 such genes for a variety of genetic disorders were identified. And this was sort of a first revolution in human genetics when we realized we had the tools to begin to approach the discovery of disease genes, not because we had an idea in advance of what gene was responsible, or we had a hypothesis about what biological process was involved, but we could do an unbiased search of the whole genome and actually use genetics to discover what the genetics and what the biology of the disease was. And this was fantastic, but it didn't work for those more complex human traits, such as height or diabetes or schizophrenia. And so while over the course of 10 to 15 years, thousands of Mendelian traits and diseases had their genes identified and had biology exposed in a very powerful way, by contrast, fewer than 10 genes in that same time period were identified for any human complex phenotype. And this was despite the fact that quite clearly a much greater investment had been made during this time period in applying the same strategies to the genetics of type 2 diabetes and hypertension and psychiatric disorders. So what was the problem? Well, some of the problem became obvious when you simply compared how genetic each of these diseases were. And it's not that complex diseases were not at all genetic. As you can see on this scale, this represents the risk to an individual that's the increased risk to an individual compared to a member of the general population if one has a sibling with a certain disease. So if I have a sibling with schizophrenia, I'm 10 times more likely to have schizophrenia than the average member of the population. That's a significant genetic component. Yet, it does pale in comparison to the fact that when one has a sibling with CF or muscular dystrophy or Huntington's, one's risk is astronomically inflated because these are very, very rare diseases and the mutations have a very high impact, are very deterministic. And to put this contrast into a little more pictorial view, for those simple Mendelian diseases, the genotype completely determines whether you get the disease. For the more complex situation, such as a late onset diabetes or hypertension, there are many, many genes and also many environmental exposures that change over the course of an individual's lifetime many different biological processes in the body. And then the medical community has decided on some thresholds at which we will treat people and call them, label them with a certain disease. So as you can imagine, this is a much less direct relationship between genes and that end disease definition than we have in the clear-cut cases of CF and Huntington's and so forth. So what I want to describe for you now is that over the last 5 years, there have been a number of critical steps taken, fundamental steps in the human genetics community that have allowed us to move past the roadblock that I described, understanding the genetics of more complex diseases, and to allow us to finally begin to gain some fundamental biological insights into more complex diseases. So the way that we would like to approach a more complex disease situation is to take, instead of the approach of studying just one family or a small number of families, we'd like to perform a genetic study of an entire human population. So let's say everybody in this room, or everybody in this room and 10 other lecture halls like it. And what we would like to try to do is to first move people to one side of the hall or the other according to whether they're affected with the disease or unaffected with the disease, or whether they're extremely tall or extremely short. And then search for specific genetic differences by scanning their entire genomes that distinguish individual cases from controls. And so this is very nice, and we had this idea, many people had this idea, you know, a decade or more ago as a positive way forward, but we had no way of technically performing such a study, and we also had absolutely no idea at this time, when the human genome was being sequenced, just how much DNA variation human beings had. And so some of the fundamental first steps that were taken were, as part of the Human Genome Project and coming out of the Human Genome Project, were the first detailed looks not simply at the complete sequence of the human genome, but also how much DNA variation there was. And this was achieved simply by, during the course of the Human Genome Sequencing Project, the same region of the genome was often sequenced multiple times from chromosomes from different individuals. We could then compare those chromosomes and begin to get insight into how much DNA variation human beings had. What we found was that it wasn't actually as much variation as it might have been, because when we compared any two chromosomes, and whether it's both of my copies of a specific chromosome or one of mine and one of anyone in the audience, we would generally find that there was a difference, a DNA variation, every 1,000 base pairs. And interestingly, when we then would look at that particular location in the genome in a large sample, so everybody else in the lecture hall, for example, we'd find that more than 9 times out of 10, this DNA variation, which was found just by comparing two chromosomes, was a common site of DNA variation, that we'd find many other people with one form and with the other form of that DNA variant. And this was important because it told us that human genetic variation was likely a shared property of all human beings that dates back to our ancestral population in Africa. I'll show you a little more evidence to that in a moment. So when I talk about genetic variation, what am I actually talking about? Most DNA variants that occur in the genome are actually very innocuous looking single nucleotide polymorphisms shown up at the top. And a single nucleotide polymorphism, sometimes referred to as a SNP, is simply a place in the genome where some chromosomes carry one letter and other chromosomes carry a different letter. And these occur quite commonly in the genome. Every few hundred base pairs, if you look at, you know, a sample of 10 or 15 people, you'll find a single nucleotide change such as that. There are many other types of DNA variants, some of which are more important, all of which occur less frequently than the single nucleotide changes, but many of which have much more significant functional consequences, like large deletions, which remove or add copies of certain genes. Now, one of the challenging things about studying DNA variation is that the DNA variants occur relatively frequently in the genome, but they don't come with a lot of fanfare, and they don't generally tell you whether they're important or not. In fact, you have to sift through a bunch of genome sequence like this. Of course, the computers do it. Nobody does this by hand. And DNA variants generally look like this. You blink and you miss them, just the change of a letter here and a letter there. And as I said, they generally don't have any particular flag attached to them that tells you that this is important or this might be related to this disease or that disease or have a certain molecular function to it. So at the point at which we discover DNA variants, they're just markers, essentially. We find a place in the DNA, we put it in our catalog, and keep it for later examination. Now, fortunately for human geneticists, as opposed to geneticists studying any other organism, humans are about the least genetically diverse organisms on the planet. In fact, with the possible exception of the cheetah that's being hunted into extinction, humans really have the lowest DNA diversity of any organisms that walk the planet, or crawl, or fly, or do anything else through the planet. As you see, when you compare two human chromosomes, you find a difference only 1 in 1,000 bases, give or take, whereas you find slightly more DNA variation when you compare two chimpanzee chromosomes. And if you go to experimental organisms, such as Drosophila, or bacteria, such as E. coli, or viral genomes, such as the HIV genome, you find much, much dramatically increased rates of DNA diversity, because these organisms are much more rapidly evolving to select for diversity. So that puts a nice cap on how many DNA variants commonly occur in human populations. And it does depend, of course, to some extent on how many individuals you look at, what this number is. But let's say, give or take, there are about 10 million common DNA variants that exist in human populations today. And we can catalog nearly all of these now and have done so over the last few years. And what we find is more evidence of what's termed the out of Africa hypothesis. And that is the fact that when we find these DNA variants, the vast majority of them are shared by all populations on all continents of the world, or there's a significant subset that are found only on the African continent. And that's, of course, because the out of Africa hypothesis says that some individuals migrated out of Africa at one point in history. Everybody didn't move out of Africa. So hence, there's a great deal of DNA variation that had built up over millions of years in Africa, only some of which was dispersed around the rest of the world. What we don't generally find is we don't find very much DNA variation at all that is unique to European populations or unique to East Asian populations. And so this, I think, is very, you know, provides us with further insight that the DNA variation that we're studying, by and large, is a shared property all human populations. So just as the human genome itself and the gene content of the human genome is shared among all populations of the world, so too are the DNA variants, or the majority of DNA variants. And this is very important because, you know, if we want to understand the biology of disease, we'd like to understand the biology of disease in all populations, not just one, so that we can develop therapies that are effective in all populations. And so this is certainly heartening information. So I'm going to turn now to focus in the next section of how these gene discoveries and how these tools have been applied to complex human diseases over the last 5 or so years. And I'm going to do this, I'm going to use an illustrative example from one disease that has made a substantial amount of progress over the last few years, this being Crohn's disease. Crohn's disease is one of the two major forms of inflammatory bowel disease, the other being ulcerative colitis. And these are chronic and debilitating and incurable, currently, inflammatory diseases of the gastrointestinal system. They are highly heritable. And if you have a sibling with Crohn's or UC, you were somewhere between 15 and 35 times more likely to have the disease yourself at some point in your lifetime. Yet these are among the many more common and complex diseases that don't follow a simple Mendelian transmission pattern and don't easily succumb to the types of traditional mapping studies that were so successful for those severe genetic diseases. So to take a more quantitative look at how genetic is inflammatory bowel disease. Well, if you have inflammatory bowel disease, then there's no enhanced risk to your neighbor. There's no major environmental cause that's been discovered yet that would predispose your neighbor to getting more inflammatory bowel disease because you had it. So it's presuming you don't live next to your direct relatives. And so an individual in the general population has about a 1 in 1,000 to a 5 in 1,000 chance of developing IBD in their lifetime. If you have a sibling, if you have IBD, the risk to your sibling is somewhere in between 1 and 10%. So this is obviously considerably inflated over the number when you look at unrelated individuals, but it doesn't mean you will definitely get IBD. It certainly doesn't look like the number for Huntington's disease, for example. If you have an identical twin, however, that number isn't 1 to 10%. It's more like 20 to 50%. So that shows these numbers taken together really show that genetics plays quite a significant role. And specifically, inherited variation in disease plays a very significant role in influencing an individual's disease risk. It doesn't completely determine it, however, and that's where the complexity comes in. So going back to around the year 2000, about 10 years ago, let's say now, no genes had yet been discovered for inflammatory bowel disease. my colleagues and I here at the precursor to the Broad Institute were focusing on a region of chromosome 5 that had been implicated with some modest support from a traditional family study. And we began a very slow, for the time, a very slow sequencing study to try to find SNPs and other types of DNA polymorphisms that might explain or might contribute to Crohn's disease risk in this particular corner of chromosome 5. So pause for a moment to give a little terminology that's often used in human genetics. You often hear people talk about genotypes and alleles. And so a genotype is essentially for a specific location in the genome, for example, over here, each individual carries, you know, two copies of each chromosome. And so if this is a polymorphic DNA base here, we may be looking at the DNA profile, a DNA sequence of an individual who carries a C and a C on one chromosome and a T on the other chromosome at that particular location. And so that individual's genotype would be described as a CT genotype. Often also referred to as heterozygous because they carry one of each of the possible alleles at that location. Haplotypes are often a shorthand for the set of bases along a chromosome at those DNA variant sites. And so instead of showing the entire sequence, which would have 99 or 99.5% of the bases being invariant among all human beings, we often just compress it to show what bases does that sequence carry at these particular variable sites. And that's often referred to as a haplotype. And so when we began almost 10 years ago looking at the DNA sequence from this first region of chromosome 5 that we decided to focus on in the Crohn's disease study, we found that we could find many single nucleotide polymorphisms, but they all sort of told us the same piece of information. And that was that we collected 8 SNPs in this particular region of chromosome 5, which is about 80,000 base pairs long. And when we examined them in hundreds of individuals, we kept finding that each chromosome that we looked at carried either these particular alleles in black or these particular alleles in blue. And the reason this was strange is that we were looking at a very diverse population from the metropolitan Toronto area, and one would have expected that in all of human history, there would have been many recombination events, which would have created all sorts of different assortments of those particular polymorphic bases. But we weren't actually seeing that. When we moved a little further down the chromosome, we did finally begin to see the places where recombination had created new assortments of chromosomes. So we'd see all these black alleles on many chromosomes and all the blue alleles on many other chromosomes. But we'd also see hybrid chromosomes that were the result of recombination during meiosis. And so we began to dissect this particular region of the genome, and this helped us to identify a specific region that contained a clear Crohn's disease risk factor. So we managed to zero in on it down to a few genes, and this was very exciting at the time because at this point, this was one of two regions that were discovered as significantly contributing to Crohn's disease risk in 2001, and that was very novel for the time because, as I said, very, very few genes had been identified for any complex human trait or disease. But it explained very little of the overall familiarity of Crohn's disease. And so we realized that while this was a good start, and we had now two of the genetic components of Crohn's disease, what this made us realize was that these two explained so little of the overall picture that there must be a very large number, and that this was not yet a significant insight into the overall pathogenesis of Crohn's disease. But what it really helped us to understand was it helped us to understand much more clearly patterns of DNA variation among humans and among human populations. And so this led, and other initial projects of this scale led to a focus on a project that came to be known as the HapMap project. It was essentially a study to create a detailed catalog of human genetic variation patterns. And so one can think of it as sort of the add-on project or the follow-on project to the Human Genome Sequencing Project. So the Human Genome Sequencing Project throughout the 90s and the early years, 2000, 2001, was targeted at creating a reference sequence, essentially the sequence of one of each chromosome in the genome. And this gives us the layout of the genes and all the important regulatory regions and so forth, and is has been invaluable to biomedicine over the last decade, yet didn't tell us anything about DNA variation. And of course, it's the DNA variation that causes some people to be at risk of some diseases and others to be protected from different diseases and so forth. And so this project was meant as a follow-on to create a detailed catalog of which sites in the genome actually commonly varied in a handful of populations in the world. And it was not intended that samples from Utah, Nigeria, and Tokyo and Beijing were meant to be representative of all the world's populations. They were just three geographically diverse points on the globe that gave us a reasonable representation of, from previous population genetic studies, would give us a reasonable representation of DNA variation. And so this project gave us, as 2005, 2006, and 2007 ticked along, gave us a fundamental understanding of DNA variation throughout the genome. So this gave us one of the missing pieces for human genetic studies. The other missing piece came in the form of technological advances that were happening at the same time. And so over the same time period, remarkable technological advances that made it possible to do studies thousands, if not millions of times larger than that one small region of chromosome 5 that took us so long to study in 2000 and 2001 came along. There were technologies that allow us to take an individual DNA, patient DNA sample, for example, these affymetrics chips over here, and look at hundreds of thousands or millions of polymorphic sites in the genome in a single experiment that takes place in a matter of days. And there's new sequencing technologies, which are just being rolled out over the last year or two, which now allow us to, in a single run of a single machine, do the entire work of the Human Genome Sequencing Project 10 times over. These are remarkable advances that make it possible now for us to realize the actual, what was just a few years ago, impossible tasks of studying in great detail thousands of genomes of cases for a disease and controls for a disease. We'll go into how those technologies work. But anyway, we go back to Crohn's disease to pursue our example a little further in light of some of these advances. So, as I said, in 2001, we had those two genes that were discovered sort of by more traditional approaches. And then over the course of the next 4 or 5 years, there were no new genes discovered for Crohn's disease. And so while we were very excited about potentially breaking through with the two findings in 2001, we realized that we were clearly in for a much deeper challenge. And this was mirrored by a great, as I described, a great lack of progress across the board in complex human diseases in this same time period. So what the new technologies and our new understanding of genome variation allowed us to really embark on, starting in 2006 and 2007, were the first of a new wave of genetic studies, a genome-wide association study. And so whereas previously we would have to have focused genome-wide studies on a small number of families and focus it on chromosomal arms, or we could have studied maybe one gene at a time and looked at DNA variants in a large population. Now we sort of merge those two approaches and take a global genome-wide approach, looking at hundreds of thousands of DNA variants throughout the genome in an unbiased fashion, and study that on literally thousands of patients and thousands of controls so that we could take, you know, really begin to realize the promise of performing an unbiased search for the genetic components of the biological processes of disease. And so we performed one of the first studies that was performed of any type was performed by a collaborative effort involving many sites in North America, supported by the NIDDK. And this was a study of about 1,000 cases of Crohn's disease and 1,000 controls. And there are many ways of summarizing the results of these studies. This is one of the more colorful but slightly less informative views of the results of these studies. And each little dot here, you imagine, is the statistical evidence for involvement in Crohn's disease at each of hundreds of thousands of points in the genome. And so what you can see is that there are some regions, a region back on chromosome 1, and this region on chromosome 16, that have very, very strong evidence, unequivocal evidence, of significant involvement in Crohn's disease. One of those, the one on chromosome 16, was the previously identified CARD15 NOD2 gene. So we rediscovered that with the study. And the other gene that we knew about had more modest support, but still quite significant, sort of 1 in 1,000 level support. But what was interesting was that we were able to begin to identify other components in this unbiased search. And so important before going to what one should look at in terms of any genetic study that's published or described in the New York Times or anything else is that were the results of this study validated independently by perhaps optimistically other researchers or at least repetitive observations in new sets of DNA samples, new families with independent DNA assessment technologies or sequencing technologies to both confirm the statistical analysis that we look at with these studies, but also to eliminate the potential for technical errors in the DNA typing that may artificially make it look like this region of the genome is interesting in a disease. So these studies require a great deal of confirmation. And when the group that I was involved in performed this confirmatory step, we identified several new loci, which clearly played significant roles in Crohn's disease. And it's not particularly important for this discussion what those are, but it began a process of discovery that began to escalate. And we quickly began to both focus on the results of our study, but also be aware that there were other studies being performed, one particular in the UK and another one in Belgium, that had a similar study design and with some similar and overlapping findings. And so we quickly changed the way in which human genetics gets done from a previous generation of genetic studies, which were very competitive. So as you can imagine, if there were 10 labs studying a Mendelian disease, one of these monogenic diseases, that it would then be a very competitive activity to try to see who could race to be the first to find the one gene involved in disease. The change in the dynamic in this particular field has been to realize that there are likely tens, maybe even hundreds of genes involved in disease, that no individual group is capable of finding them all, but that we can get a lot of additional value out of combining the cases and controls in our different studies. And so this process began to take place, whereas some genes were found by individual genome-wide association studies, many more genes were found when these studies across the UK and Belgium were combined with our study done in North America. And in just over 2 years, this collaborative process was able to so dramatically accelerate the gene discovery process that we now know more than 30 of the biological components to Crohn's disease. And this is now beginning to critically shape the way in which we think about the what causes this disease and how we might go about treating it. So one of the, just to give you an example of how this process goes forward, well, we realized very quickly that two of the first genes that were identified, their names are ATG16L1 and IRGM, geneticists are not known for clarity in their shorthand of gene names, were involved in a process known as autophagy. Now, autophagy is a cellular process that helps keep cells healthy. And when old organelles die or when bacteria invade the cell, autophagy is a frontline mechanism for getting rid of those invaders or those decaying cellular components to maintain the health of the cell. And in particular, a colleague of mine at the MGH, Ramnik Xavier, was able to show that in particular, this ATG16L1 gene, that's the very exciting name, was critical for a cell's essential and innate response to invading bacteria. And that when you knock down this gene, or when the Crohn's disease mutation is carried by an individual, this response to bacteria is greatly suppressed. And what you can see here is, in a normal, healthy cell that has a full complement of this gene, the invading salmonella that are marked in red are coated and digested by the cell. And that coating and digestion process is sort of marked with the green fluorescence. And that when that gene is turned off or knocked down or the Crohn's mutation is carried, that the invading bacteria are not attacked by the cell and thus go on to cause more damage. And so this is just sort of one example of how the genetics are beginning to give us fundamental insight into the biological processes of disease. So it was long hypothesized that bacterial triggers were very important and a key to understanding the flare-ups of individuals in Crohn's and ulcerative colitis, and actually played a key role. But it was unknown exactly how that took place. And so now, through what's exposed by the genetic study, we now have some fundamental insight into the actual biology of that process. And this gives us a great hope to begin a process by which we might reverse that. And I'll just cite that, you know, while a great deal of progress has been made in diseases such as Crohn's and UC and other autoimmune diseases, and also many in late onset diabetes and other metabolic diseases. There's also beginning, the same types of studies are beginning to identify genetic components for even more complex disorders such as autism and schizophrenia. And these are really offering us hope, even in these most complex of diseases, that we may get a better handle in upcoming years on the biology of these diseases. But of course, the whole point of this is that genetics is really just the first step. And I hope that over the course of the lecture series, you'll hear about many of the other critical steps that are downstream of our understanding of the fundamental biology of disease. And that genetics really is just part of, in our view, a discovery process that critically starts with patients, discovers genes which define risk or protection in those patients, then uses those genes to uncover, define the biological processes that actually cause disease in humans. We're not working with models of disease in yeast or mice at this point yet. We want to define what causes the disease in humans. So because once we know those processes that influence disease in humans, we can discover chemical compounds that fix those broken processes. And we can then use mice and other model organisms to explore how to fix those processes, but not presuming that we need to cause Crohn's disease in a mouse in order to fix that biological process. And then once we have compounds that can fix those broken processes that we've learned through genetics, those compounds are the ones that then have a much greater chance of succeeding as drugs downstream because they actually address the fundamental biological flaws of disease. And so with that, I invite questions. Hope everyone can stay and enjoy a bit of the reception afterwards, and hope that you will come back and hear about many of the other exciting aspects of the biological research that's going on at the Broad Institute over the next few weeks.
I have a question.
Yes.
If you go back several slides, there was the graphic. Right there. So that's a readout of a whole genome scan.
It's a readout of a whole genome associated, right? And if you're the more quantitatively minded, the y-axis represents the statistical evidence of relationship between the DNA variant represented by each dot and Crohn's disease. And these thresholds here, if you can read them off, are 5 and 7, which represent sort of 1 in 100,000 evidence and 1 in 10 million evidence that the DNA variant would be involved. And so if we study a few hundred thousand variants, we might not be convinced when a DNA variant reaches this blue line, but we might think it's interesting enough to follow up in additional studies. We would probably be very convinced when a DNA variant crosses the red line that it has to be involved with Crohn's disease if we've performed our study in a technically sound manner. Yes?
It sounds like it's a group of genes that sort of coordinate these diseases, right? So like that was one thing, and it's a small group. Is that a very consistent feature for what you would go from all these diseases? It's not a cast of thousands, but it's a little committee.
Right. And so far, this is what we've discovered in autoimmune diseases and in metabolic diseases, for example, that we are able to have found thus far, 20 or 30 or 50 genes related to these diseases. And then when we begin to put those into biological processes, we found that they generally boil down into, 4, 5, 6 distinct biological processes which influence the disease. And so then when we begin to think about therapies, it may be more important what those processes are and less important what the specific genes with the DNA variation are. Because we might discover a biological process and discover that it's a different gene that is the best way of modulating that process, something upstream of it, maybe. Yeah. Oh, sure. Yeah.
Is that down the line, instead of drugs developed to do something about Crohn's or schizophrenia or autism or something, could you manipulate these genes?
Well, I think that is a possibility, and if we have, I don't know if we have any lecture from the chemical biology program later on, but that's very much what they're focused on, and is the limitation in drug development has been that we have a set of compounds that the pharmaceutical industry uses that really modulate only a small number of biological processes in the body, and that what we need is a much more diverse set of chemicals and drugs to be developed that modulate many different biological processes so that we can meet up in a middle ground between drug development and human genetics and figure out what the best approach to treating each disease is. Yes?
Given you've talked about how the different organisms, the humans having the least genetic variation and viral mechanisms having the most genetic variation, would you suggest that at least in the near future, some of this research will be very challenging for those organisms that have mutations into, say, viral diseases because of that mutation? Or I just didn't know what you thought.
Well, it's actually a really good question. There's actually initiatives here at the Broad and elsewhere to try to match up in a very challenging fashion the genetic susceptibility in humans to different populations of viruses, different populations of bacteria, and in particular, and also in parasites as well. In particular, malaria, TB, and HIV in particular get a lot of attention, hepatitis as well, as examples where there's a great deal of disease caused in the human population by these, yet there's a great deal of diversity in those organisms. And what we don't yet know is how attuned the genetic diversity in the population of the pathogen is to the genetic diversity in humans. And the genetic diversity in humans obviously evolves much more slowly. And we clearly do have examples where where particular pathogens have exerted a great deal of selective influence on the human genome. But I think it's an outstanding question as to how much that diversity in the population seems to affect or may affect human response. It seems that, at least from an early point, the set of human immune responses are limited enough that the key genetic components that make individuals differently susceptible act in, to some extent, an independent fashion of what the invading pathogen is. And in fact, many of the bacterial response genes in human affect a whole wide range of bacteria. But there are bound to be examples where the evolution is so rapid of, for example, HIV or hepatitis, where specific subtypes of those viruses may be governed by different responses. Yes?
Daly, back in April, there was a report in the New England Journal of Medicine that described, that actually kind of criticized genome association studies. I'm sure you're familiar with it. The authors were claiming that the diseases in which genome-wide association studies had been applied to study like cancer or diabetes, in fact, only explained a modest risk in the individuals that were carrying the genes. And there was a contending line of research that promoted looking at, instead of looking at tens of common variants, looking at thousands of rare genetic, rare genes as a way to explain disease. I'd like to hear your commentary on that other approach and versus your expertise in genome association studies.
Right. So I think the approaches are actually one and the same, in that each approach becomes possible as technology advances. So what became possible in the time frame 2005 to the current time was that we had technologies that would allow us to study common variants in very large patient and control populations. We're now just at the cusp of these new sequencing technologies that will actually allow us for the first time to look at rarer DNA variants in similarly very large numbers of cases and controls. And the common denominator is that any genetic study needs to be focused on very large numbers of patients, because whether the variation is common or rare, the you know, undeniable fact is that there are many tens, if not hundreds, of genes involved in most of these complex diseases. And we don't expect that any individual gene can contribute enough that it will be obvious when we look at just, you know, 10 patients or five families of what's going to happen. So rather than focus on the dichotomy, which I think is, you know, a variety of approaches will lead to discoveries of the genes involved in disease, I think we're trying to take a broader approach that encompasses all of those hypotheses for different diseases, but focused on it not actually mattering when you discover that a gene is related to disease, whether the DNA variation is very rare and has a high impact, or whether it's very common and has a low impact. In fact, now we have, having been able to take complementary approaches to human disease over the past few decades, we're now learning that the same genes generally get exposed when you take these complementary approaches. So take, for example, the example of the extraordinarily high cholesterol mutations that occur in a very small fraction of families and populations in the world. These were studied over the course of the 70s and 80s and 90s. It resulted in the identification of more than 10 genes that clearly harbor, when they harbor severe mutations, give rise to these very high or very low levels of cholesterol in certain families. And these you can think of as just sort of Mendelian diseases, but the disease is just having extremely high or extremely low cholesterol. So now when we come along and do a genome-wide association study of cholesterol levels, we find that there are common variants in different parts of the genome that are associated to cholesterol levels very reliably, and there's been a good 20 or 30 of those documented. The fascinating thing is that there's almost a complete overlap between the set of genes that are defined by those Mendelian studies and the set of genes that are defined by these new genome-wide studies. In addition, there are a bunch of other genes that are found by the genome-wide association studies that were not found by the Mendelian studies, but we expect that when we look with the sequencing technology that we'll probably find rare mutations in those genes as well. And so I think that when we look hard at a gene, we very often find that there are both common DNA variants that maybe change the level of the gene a little bit and confer a small amount of risk in the population, as well as very rare mutations which may debilitate the gene and cause disease in a very severe way, but in a very small fraction of the population. And I think the important thing is to think of those as providing equal and equivalent insight into the biology of the disease. So at the end of the day, it's not so important what type of DNA variant you find, whether it's common or rare or a deletion or a duplication. But what's important is that each of those observations, regardless of what kind of study provided the insight, gives you that information about the biological process of disease that can be acted on. And then when you go to changing that biological process in drug development, it's not that process doesn't really care about the naturally arising DNA variants that contributed to the discovery. It's concerned with modulating a biological process, such as the uptake or the cleaning out of cholesterol, in everybody, regardless of their genotype.